What a text, huh? What are we to make of this? The sinless Jesus sits in the temple outer precincts, which is the court of the Gentiles, the outer ring of the temple, which is to be a house of prayer for all people. And he braids a whip. He makes a whip. He just doesn't all of a sudden get up and storm through the temple. This is deliberate. How long does it take to make a whip? What does he make it out of? Did he bring the materials for the whip with him? Or does he take the straw from where the oxen and the cattle and all of those have been, or reeds, and weave them together? It takes some doing to make a whip. It's sort of like making a guitar, right, Bill? It takes a while. It takes a while to make a guitar. It takes a while to make a whip. So what is he doing? Dom Helder Camara, the great Bishop of Recife in Brazil, who was known as the Bishop of the Poor, said, if you give people food, they call you a saint. If you go after the institutions that make people hungry, they crucify you. How about that? What is happening here that has made Jesus so angry and that has brought him into this court of the Gentiles, sitting there braiding his whip and then driving these money changers out of the temple? Well, first of all, it is the house of God, right? You have made my father's house a den of robbers, says one of the other, a den of thieves, crooks. In Minneapolis and in Chicago and in New York and even here in Chaska, there's a place where you can go if you have bad credit or you don't have a bank account. You can go there and they will exchange your money or cash your check, and they take 25% off the top for giving you their money. That's called money exchange. In the temple, you could not go into the temple and do temple worship with Roman coinage. Why? Because on the coin of general commerce was the coin of the Roman Empire with the image of Caesar. Caesar is God's son. Caesar is God. You shall make no graven image. You are created in the image of God. You are not created in the image of Caesar. So the rule of the temple was you exchanged that stuff in the outer court before you came closer to the center of the temple to worship. You did not come in there with Roman coinage. You exchanged it for a shekel. Now, so it was a denarius or a drachma. People came in with these Roman coins. They were exchanged for a shekel, which was the temple coinage. No image on it. The people who are in the outer courtyard, where Jesus is sitting braiding a whip, are the functionaries of the father-in-law of the high priest, who is the former high priest, but who continues to own all the business operations of the temple. Okay? So they're out there, and you couldn't bring in an ox or, you know, a lamb or your own bird, because it needed to be sanctified, made holy by the temple authorities, by the authorities, the high priest. Had to be kosher. So if you came in there, you had to buy these things. Some of them could afford big animals, like us, right? Maybe one or two of us, maybe, could afford a big animal. But for the poor, all the poor could afford was a dove or a pigeon. Someone else said that if you see people floating down the river and they've been injured or hurt and they come by you, you can and should bandage their wounds and care for them, acts of compassion. But at some point, you have to ask the question, what's happening upriver? Who's beating these people up and sending them down the river to us? There's an institutional question here. Jesus is taking on the institution of the high priesthood because it has abused its rightful authority. And so he braids a whip and he drives these people out. And the tables are flying and money is flying. Jesus is outraged and he is outrageous. How do you feel about that? Huh? You know, I love the pictures of Christmas. Jesus is a baby in his mother's arms. Well, this is not a baby in his mother's arms. This is an occupier. Isn't it? He is attacking the financial system of the temple. And the financial system of the interior of workings of the temple is in cahoots with the Roman Empire. Let's be clear about this. This is not just about religion. It is about the relationship between the religion of an occupied people and the Roman Empire. And so the temple authorities have made a deal with Rome, with the Roman Empire, which said basically, you let us do our thing and you go ahead and do your thing. No. These two are on collision course. So I wonder, the Jesus of my faith and the Jesus of your faith, I think, you tell me, is the Jesus who is making peace, not stirring up conflict, not stirring up hatred, not stirring up stereotyping and all of the divisions that divide us. The Jesus that we love and follow is the Jesus who is making peace, reconciling us to God and reconciling us with one another, right? Isn't that what it's about? When Paul says the message of the cross is folly. To those who can't hear it, substitute another word. The message of execution. The message that is linked to execution. Cross is execution. How about that one? The message that a crucified and executed criminal against the Roman state and against the high priesthood of the temple is the linchpin of the Christian faith. What do you think then? That's nuts. Is it? I'm thinking out loud here. I'm asking you questions that I don't know how to resolve myself. But it's very, very clear in this particular text and in the Gospel of John that the reason that Jesus is executed, the reason he is taken to the cross, is because of what he did in the temple that day. John's gospel puts this right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, and he puts it back to back with the wedding at Cana. Jesus is about the wedding, turning water into wine. He wants the party to begin. He wants all of us to come to the party. And then he goes right into the place where the party is being compromised. One might even say destroyed. Where the wine is being turned into water, or something less than water, into poison. And that's later, at the end, why they crucify him. Where it gets sticky, it seems to me, is, someone else has said, this is, the reason that we, how many here, people here love Nelson Mandela, for instance? Okay, Nelson Mandela, why do we love Nelson Mandela? We love Nelson Mandela because he suffered? No. We love Nelson Mandela because he was a man of courage and integrity, wasn't he? He is, I mean, he's not gone yet, I don't think. But he was a man of courage and integrity. We don't love Martin Luther King because he suffered. We love Martin Luther King because he was a man of principle and courage and integrity. And he was assassinated because of that. And Jesus was crucified because he was a person of integrity and courage, who dared to take on the institutions and the principalities and the powers that kept sending the bodies down the river. So better check upstream. Something's not right here. Check upstream to look at the institutions and the forces and the powers that are sending these bodies down the river. So how we do this, brothers and sisters, how we follow the outraged and outrageous Jesus without being pompous, self-righteous. You know what I'm talking about. It's very unbecoming, and it's very easy for me, maybe it's not for you, right? At the Lenten series on Wednesday night, John and I led the Lenten series, and we had these very graphic pictures, right, of the crucifixion. We wanted to make sure you all got it, that this is really ugly stuff, and that this is real. And as I looked around the room, and I later talked to one of the women in the group who I sleep with, I could see on the faces of the women, I could see it on your face, Alice, kind of wincing. Ugh, God, I don't want to look at this stuff. I don't want to see this. And the question finally that Kay asks is, how could somebody do this? How could somebody put a man on a cross? And John and I, good philosophers and theologians that we were, well, we tried to answer that question. That's not the way to deal with that. That was an existential cry of protest. This is awful. Right? This is simply horrible. Maybe where we need to go is into the statement, the existential cry. This is simply horrible. And stay there for a while. And go inward to ask, why is it so horrible? And where is the beauty here? And I suggest to you that the beauty, just to think about, the beauty is not of a man suffering. The beauty is of a man of courage and principle who would not bend to the destructive marriage, not the marriage at Cana, but the destructive marriage and the destroying marriage of the state and religion. Think about it. John and I are going to turn it over to the women this Tuesday night to see what the other gender has to say about these questions. What's that? Wednesday night. You all come on Tuesday night, nobody will be here. But Wednesday evening, if you're interested, so that we can get a women's, or not a women's, but women's point of view on all of this, on Jesus and the cross. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you as people who want so badly to do the right thing, and who look at the stories of Jesus and sometimes are perplexed, have lots of questions. And we wonder sometimes how to follow him in ways that engage the powers that be, and yet seek the way of peace and nonviolence. So let your healing grace, your clarifying grace, work in our consciences and our hearts to bring us to your way and your truth, your justice and your love, through Christ our Lord. Amen.